Well, good afternoon, and welcome to the second lecture of the 2015-16 Clarence R. Noe Dean's Lecture Series. I'm Dr. Daniel Blankenship. I'm the Provost and Dean of Eureka College. These interdisciplinary lecture series have showcased the talent and depth of the faculty at Eureka College, thanks to the generosity of the Noe family. The Dean's Lecture Series was begun by Dr. Jerry D. McCoy in 1980. Dr. McCoy is here. Welcome. The series was stimulated to create discussion among the college faculty to offer enrichment to students and friends of the college. In 1992, the Dean's Lecture Series was renamed in honor of the late Dr. Clarence R. Noe, who served as academic dean from 1955 to 1977, so a bit of history there. The series continues through the gifts made by family and friends. Throughout the 35-year history of the series, special emphasis has been given to topics reaching across the academic fields. Tonight, we'll be hearing from Associate Professor of Psychology, Dr. Marygrace Yale Kaiser. Dr. Kaiser earned her bachelor's degree in psychology from Illinois Wesleyan University and her master's degree and PhD in applied developmental psychology from the University of Miami. Dr. Kaiser also completed a postdoctoral fellowship at the Vanderbilt University Kennedy Center, one of the 12 original intellectual and developmental disability research centers funded by the National Institutes of Child Health and Human Development. Before coming to Eureka College, Dr. Kaiser served as the research director of the University of Miami Linda Ray Intervention Center and the University of Miami Autism and Developmental Disabilities Mentoring Project. Tonight, Dr. Kaiser will discuss the core features of autism spectrum disorder, present some of the recent research results, and highlight the challenges in interpreting these findings as it pertains to individuals with ASD, their families, and society. Please welcome Dr. Marygrace Yale Kaiser.
Thank you, Dr. Blankenship. I'm going to thank all of you right at the onset for joining me today on this cold and rainy Thursday afternoon. I know November is a very busy time for faculty, staff, and students alike, so again, I appreciate your attendance here. I'm going to be talking about autism spectrum disorders, which is a set of complex neurodevelopmental disorders which can result in difficulties in social interactions, communication, and some significant behavioral challenges when it comes to restricted interests and repetitive behaviors. I'm going to be talking about the spectrum, anchoring my talk with some significant numbers and how it relates to the disorder. And I'm going to start out with the number 12. I was 12 years old when I first found out, or remember finding out about autism spectrum disorders. And my students that are here will not be surprised to know that I found out about it through watching TV. A lot of the examples I use in class have to do with characters from TV shows, and this is no exception. So, when I was 12 years old, watching a television show by the name of St. Elsewhere, so this was prior to Grey's Anatomy, prior to ER, in St. Elsewhere, there was a character by the name of Tommy Westfall. And Tommy was the son of one of the main characters of the show, and he had autism. Some of the behaviors that Tommy displayed involved self-injurious behavior. He would bang his head against the wall and slam himself into other objects. He didn't talk, and he rarely made eye contact with other individuals. His father had a very hard time sort of connecting with him, both emotionally and communicating with him and understanding what it was that Tommy was feeling and experiencing. Probably many of you are familiar with this depiction of an autism spectrum disorder, and that came a little bit later in my life through the movie Rain Man. So Dustin Hoffman portrayed a character by the name of Raymond Babbitt. He was an adult with an autism spectrum disorder who grew up in a very controlled atmosphere in an institution. It wasn't until he took a cross-country trip with his brother, who had not known that he even existed, that some of the behaviors which are characterized or consistent with the disorder became apparent. So Raymond needed to watch People's Court at 4 o'clock every afternoon, or he got really, really upset. His underwear had to be purchased from Walmart, not from any other store, and he wanted things in very particular ways. He also had an aversion to being touched or to being held, which was something that Tommy from St. Elsewhere also displayed as well. A characteristic, though, that Raymond displayed that was different than the one from St. Elsewhere was that Raymond had this spectacular skill that involved numbers. And he used this skill with numbers, whether it was remembering very specific dates and times in which events occurred, or use it to his brother's advantage in counting cards in Las Vegas. Both of these characters are examples of individuals with autism. There's some consistency in some of the challenges that they face. They're both male, and that's consistent with what we know about the disorder as well, but in no way, shape, or form are these the only examples of individuals on the autism spectrum. This particular set of disorder has a lot of variability with how the disorder manifests or presents itself. I could have a room of individuals who are diagnosed on the spectrum who all met the same diagnostic criteria, but could display very, very different behaviors and unique challenges. So, 1943 is when the idea of autism was first published. And it was done so by Dr. Leo Kanner, who published a paper describing 11 children that he described as having a powerful desire for aloneness and sameness. He described these children as being happiest when they are left alone, for being sort of oblivious to other things around them. He also noticed some behavioral characteristics, such as spinning in circles and playing with the wheels of the car. He also noted some odd use of language in that they might repeat certain phrases over and over again or refer to themselves in the third person. Kanner's description of autism came to be known as infantile autism in the field of psychology and psychiatry. He borrowed the term of autism actually from the researcher Eugene Bleuler, who was the one who was doing a lot of work significant to schizophrenia. This idea, how it was related to schizophrenia, was focused on some of the inward, sort of self-absorbed aspect that we see many times in adults with schizophrenia. But Kanner wanted to be clear that autism was not an early form of schizophrenia. For one thing, many of the behaviors or characteristics were present from very early age, which is different from schizophrenia. And the clinical signs of the two disorders were significantly different. So the next number is 299.0, which is a number that is kind of imprinted in my mind. This is the code that is given to autism spectrum disorders in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual. The Diagnostic and Statistical Manual is the handbook that we as psychologists, psychiatrists, clinicians use, which is the classification and the diagnostic criteria for several mental disorders. So we use these criteria when evaluating individuals for developmental or mental disorders, and this is sort of the index number autism in the DSM. Even though Kanner first reported descriptions of autism back in the 40s, it wasn't until 40 years later in the 1980s that the term autism first appeared in the DSM. And it went through sort of several versions talk about these different disorders and how they were sort of designated in the DSM. Prior to our latest version of the DSM-5, we used to talk about autism spectrum disorders as specific subtypes or specific forms of the disorder. So we had autistic disorder, which was separate from Asperger's syndrome, which was separate from pervasive developmental disorder not otherwise specified, which was separate from child disintegrated disorder. Each of these disorders had some differences when it comes to age of onset and sort of symptom presentation, but what they all had in common was difficulties or impairments with social interactions, and usually these fixated interests in some of these repetitive behavioral patterns. In 2003, the APA, the American Psychiatric Association, gave us their newest version of the DSM-5. And one of the big changes in that version was that all of the autism spectrum subtypes were now going to be listed under one umbrella subtypes, autism spectrum disorders. So the DSM-5 was updated in 2013. And again, there were many changes that happened in the manual, but one of the most controversial changes had to do with the way they were now defining or characterizing autism. One of the things the work groups discovered when they were working through revisions was that there was some variability or some inconsistency with the way in which clinicians were diagnosing the separate subtypes in different areas. So they felt it was more accurate to refer to these group of disorders under this one umbrella category of autism spectrum disorders. Another significant change had to do with the areas of impairment that define these particular sets of disorders. Prior to the DSM-5, there were three areas that we often looked at. Deficits in social interaction skills, deficits or delays in communication behaviors, and then these restricted behaviors and repetitive interests. In the newest version of the DSM, we now have two categories of impairment. What they did is they combined the social interaction and the communication deficit into one category, and then they kept the areas or the issues with restricted repetitive patterns of behaviors or interests. It's important to note, though, that while the criteria for autism spectrum disorder have changed, the way in which we diagnose the disorder, or the methods that we use to diagnose the disorder have not changed from the DSM-4 to the DSM-5. Gold standard diagnosis of this particular set of behaviors includes an extensive developmental history, which oftentimes involves interviews with parents and other caregivers or professionals who have worked with the child, in addition to direct observation of the child where they are presented with a series of sort of functional and social tasks. So that hasn't changed, but what we're looking for may have changed slightly. Like I said, we now have two core areas of impairment: the persistent deficits in social communication and social interaction, and the restrictive repetitive patterns of behavioral interests and activities. One of the things that's always challenging in describing or talking about how we go about diagnosing an autism spectrum disorder has to do with what we use to meet these diagnostic criteria. It's important that clinicians and others are aware that you need more than one example of a specific behavior in order to meet criteria for one of these deficits. So one example of one of the specific criteria is not sufficient. What we're looking for is behavior that is clearly atypical, clearly causing dysfunction in the individual's life, and is present across multiple contexts. One of the things that I often caution some of my students when we talk about diagnostic criteria is don't go around thinking like you're gonna start being able to diagnose this in your friends and your roommates and your parents. Many of us will display some of these behaviors at some time. We're not all on the spectrum, right? People on the spectrum present these challenges, challenging behaviors, again, in multiple contexts, across multiple situations, and they're atypical at a sort of more severe or higher level. So, the three areas, specific areas that we're looking for when we look for deficits in social communication and social interaction have to do with issues with social-emotional reciprocity. These reflect problems of social initiation and social response. So some examples of this are an individual or child who doesn't share toys or doesn't look to involve other people in their play. Those of you that have been around a 2 or 3 year old, many times all they want you to do is to get you to look at what they're looking at, right? See. What we see a lot of times in children on the autism spectrum is they don't try and draw other people into their play. They don't draw other people into their interactions. They're not likely to try and get someone else to look at and pay attention to what they are looking at. We also don't see, another example of this is a reduced sharing of affect or emotion. One of the earliest signs is a child that doesn't respond to a social smile. Okay, in many situations when you smile at a child or at a person, most often they'll smile back at you. The child that doesn't respond to praise, a child that doesn't share in the enjoyment or the sad or negative emotions of another person. Another deficit that we're looking at has to do with the use of nonverbal communication behaviors. So one of the clear signs of this is an impaired use of eye contact. A lot of individuals on the autism spectrum find it difficult to look people in the eyes. They avoid it. They may many times look at their mouth when they have to look at their face. Impaired use of body posture. They may turn their back to someone when they're talking to them. They may not use gestures like pointing or nodding or shaking their head in an easy or useful way. Another example of this deficit has to do with the sort of tone or prosody of their voice. It may be abnormal as far as volume or pitch or intonation. Some people have described the way in which some individuals with on the spectrum speak as sounding very robotic. And they also have a difficulty in coordinating nonverbal behaviors with verbal behaviors. So when they're talking, they may not be looking. Or they're gesturing and talking but not looking. So they have a hard time sort of bringing all of these communication behaviors together for effective communication. And the last area has to do with problems developing and maintaining relationships. And this reflects problems in sort of social awareness. When it's, whether it's appropriate to show interest in other people, to want other people to be around. We oftentimes see deficits or problems in children on the spectrum making friends or maintaining those friendships. They're often described as sort of preferring solitary activities, being very withdrawn, being sort of aloof, and it not bothering them that other people are around, or even they may even be unaware that other people are around. You have to have significant behaviors across multiple contexts in each of these three areas to meet diagnostic criteria. We also need examples of behavioral deficits that have to fall in at least 2 of these 4 categories. So the first one has to do with atypical speech movements or play. Oftentimes we see stereotypic or repetitive speech. They will repeat the same thing over and over again. We call this echolalia. They may have sort of repetitive vocalizations that they say in very rote ways. We often also see stereotypic motor mannerisms, like shaking their hands or wringing their fingers. They may spin or rock. They may walk on their toes. And then we also see sort of stereotypic or repetitive use of objects. They will drop items into a bucket over and over and over again. They will line toys up, okay? Not play with the toys, but line them up in a row. They may open and close doors repetitively or turn lights on and off. We also see this insistence on sameness and rituals and routines. So this is the fact that Raymond had to watch People's Court at 4 o'clock. These routines, it's not just someone wanting to be organized and not just someone being on time, but it is, if there's any deviation from that routine, you're going to wake up, change your clothes, eat breakfast, pack your backpack. If you try and change your clothes, or you try and pack your backpack before you change your clothes, that's not something that is going to work for that child. They may become very, very upset with a trivial change in a routine or a pattern. One child that I was working with got very upset one day that I came in because I was wearing my glasses, right? The fact that I had not been wearing my glasses for the time he saw me and I had glasses for the first time was very upsetting to him. We also see this very restricted or somewhat strange interests. So this can involve a very narrow range of interests, whether it's dinosaurs, that's a very common one, or weather, or sports facts. And it's not just being someone who knows a lot of trivia. It is a fixation such that everything they want to talk about is going to be about SpongeBob, right? It's not just liking SpongeBob. Everything has to focus on SpongeBob. Their conversations will focus on SpongeBob. Their clothes will be with SpongeBob. We oftentimes see children on the spectrum having to carry around or hold a specific object in their hand. And it can be something as random as a pencil or a piece of string. The last sort of area of impairment here has to do with atypical sensory behaviors. A lot of children on the spectrum have a very high tolerance to pain. And they also have either an attraction or aversion to certain textures. I've known a lot of children that have a very difficult time getting their nails cut or their hair cut because even that little tactile sensation is something that is overwhelming and uncomfortable to them. This can affect their eating patterns. Many of them don't like the textures of certain foods and have sort of difficulty with that. But there's also an attraction where shiny objects or really soft objects kind of draw and fixate their focus. You need to have at least two of these areas to meet this criteria. And again, any of these behaviors that I've talked about are ones that we need to notice and are present in early childhood. So this is usually before the age of 8. Now it's important to note that most diagnoses of autism spectrum disorders don't happen when they're very young, but some of these challenging behaviors are observed when they are younger. Okay, so 6 is our next number. And this is the median age of a first ASD diagnosis. Why this is worrisome for many of us is that experienced clinicians who work with individuals on the spectrum can reliably diagnose the spectrum as early as 2 or 3. But it's pretty consistent in the literature that many individuals, even though they have parents have concerns when they're much younger, don't receive their diagnosis until a few years later, until they're between 5 and 6. This large gap is problematic because the earlier in which We can start services, the better it is for the child. And if there is this age, this year gap that we've seen, we are losing time in providing some of these services. There's a lot of variability with when autism spectrum disorders are first diagnosed. Like I said, the sort of median age in many studies is around 6. Some factors that are related to earlier diagnosis have to do with being male. Males tend to be diagnosed somewhat younger. Having a low IQ and having experienced some type of developmental regression. This is when a child has a skill, but then they seem to lose that behavior. This is not surprising because oftentimes these characteristics are represented in some of our more severe cases of individuals on the spectrum. So this finding, thinking about age of diagnosis, was sort of the jumping off point for a project that I had three Eureka students actually assist me on a couple of years ago. And what they were interested in looking at was the initial diagnosis of children who were eventually diagnosed with an ASD. So when did that happen and what their initial diagnosis was. So I had three students working with me on this project, and they were doing a secondary data analysis of some data I had brought with me from Miami. They looked at 350 children, majority of them were Hispanic, we were from Miami, who were eventually diagnosed with an autism spectrum disorder. About 85% were male, which is not surprising. And what they looked at was what was the initial age of diagnosis and then what was the first diagnosis. So in this particular sample, the median age or the middle age of initial diagnosis was about 4 years, which is younger than the results I just showed you, but is consistent with some more current results which have just come out. But interestingly enough, about a third of the sample had their first diagnosis being a disorder other than a spectrum disorder. And some of the common initial non-ASD categories were speech and language disorders, sociocommunication disorders, and developmental delay. Again, these children all eventually were diagnosed with an autism spectrum disorder later in their life. Just to brag a little bit, these students submitted this abstract to the Gatlinburg Conference on Intellectual and Developmental Disabilities, and it was a blind review where their abstracts were reviewed and scored, just like abstracts coming from other faculty members or graduate students, and their research was deemed important enough and met certain criteria that their posters were accepted for the conference, and they were able to travel up to Chicago and present their findings at the international conference. So I was really, really proud of them. Okay, 5 is our next number. And 5 is kind of clued by the fact that the sample we talked about previously was predominantly male. So ASD is 5 times more likely in boys than in girls. And this is something that has been consistent since Kanner first started reporting on instances of the disorder. More recently, instead of just sort of accepting the fact that boys are more likely to be diagnosed, other researchers have started to look at why we see this sort of gender bias when it comes to ASD. One explanation might be that males in general are more susceptible to organic damage when it comes to infection, when it comes to inherited disease, when it comes to other conditions. So it might be because we know we're pretty sure that one of the causes of autism has to be organic or biological, that boys are going to be more vulnerable to this set of disorders compared to our girls. Another suspicion is that it has something to do with the X chromosome. Okay, so my students that are here, those in GenPsych and child development, we've talked about that boys have an X and a Y chromosome, and our girls have an X and an X chromosome. So the boys will inherit that X chromosome from their mothers. Girls will inherit the X chromosome from their mothers and their fathers. In 2000, it was first proposed that the reason we see so much more autism in boys than in girls is that it has something to do with that X chromosome that boys are inheriting from their mothers. And it was hypothesized that the fact that girls have two X chromosomes might protect them from developing the disorder, in that if there is some type of gene mutation or impaired gene on the X chromosome, their corresponding X chromosome will sort of cancel that out. And this has been followed up with more recent studies looking at gene variants, particularly on that X chromosome. And just recently, just I think late 2014, maybe early 2015, there was a study that was done that looked at over 16,000, the genetic profiles of over 16,000 individuals, both in the United States and in Switzerland. And what they found was that girls tended to have more genetic mutations compared to boys. However, boys were more vulnerable to the smaller number of genetic mutations that they had. So it might be that girls need a lot more of these genetic mutations to actually develop the disorder, when a boy could have the identical genetic mutation and develop the disorder with fewer problems. Okay, greater than 200,000%. This is kind of the figure which triggered the idea starting in early 2000 that there was an epidemic of autism. And this is actually coming from some data that came out of California. So in California, there are these regional developmental disability service centers across the state that serve individuals with developmental disabilities, not just autism, but any developmental disabilities. And what they found was, when looking at clients who are receiving services as one of their DDS centers for autism from 1990 until very recently, 2014, that there was this significant increase in individuals that were having services or having services provided for autism. Now, this increase is outpacing the increase we see in live births. And it was also outpacing, or more than could be explained with just more people receiving services from the DDS centers. I read something that for every one individual in California that was eligible for DDS services for autism in 1990, there are now 20 more of those individuals in California today. And again, this was one of the first things that led to this idea that there might be an epidemic of autism. So I'm oftentimes asked that question, and we were asked this back in the early 2000s. In order to say there's an epidemic, we first need to know what the baseline prevalence of a particular disorder or illness is. And prior to 2000, we didn't really have a good idea of what that baseline can be. Prevalence describes the number of cases of a disorder or a disease in a particular area over a particular specified period of time. When you're doing prevalence, it's really important to be very specific in how you're going to define a case of a disorder. And so we couldn't just do prevalence studies by looking at number of individuals that are diagnosed with autism spectrum disorders in different areas in the United States. Because even though we have the same diagnostic criteria, people can apply that in very different ways. So if we look at just the number of cases of diagnosed cases of autism in Oregon and compare it to the number of diagnosed cases of autism in New York, it's really comparing apples to oranges. Clinicians in Oregon may be applying the diagnostic criteria in a different way than those in New York, and there are different reasons why people may do that. So until we had a systematic way to define cases of ASD in the same way across different sites, we would have difficulty establishing this baseline and difficulty seeing if there's an increase of this baseline across time. So this number is probably one that is not unfamiliar to you. The 1 in 68 is the most recent prevalence estimates of ASD in the United States that were released by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. And this is based on 8-year-old children from 11 states in the 2010 surveillance year, meaning these are based on children who were 8 years old in 2010. And this is what is in the commercials and on the flyers and on websites. And what we hear often as a rallying cry for how many more individuals with autism we now have in our community. We'll talk a little bit about how the CDC goes about estimating prevalence using large population-based samples. The CDC, in addition, or the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, in addition to monitoring diseases like cancer and heart disease, also monitors the prevalence of developmental disabilities, and they've been doing that since the early 90s. They originally were sort of limiting their surveillance efforts to the metropolitan Atlanta effort, and in 2000, they expanded their surveillance of autism and other developmental disabilities nationwide by forming the Autism and Developmental Disabilities Monitoring Network, and we refer to this as the ADAM Network. The goal here is to provide comparable population-based ASD prevalence rates in different sites across the United States. What the network was going to do is they were going to apply the same case finding methodology and the same case definitions to children across the United States such that when we had estimates from the different sites, we were able then to compare apples to apples. So the prevalence method or methods used by the ADAM network involves a two-step process. The first involves finding children who are suspected of having an ASD and abstracting records or information from their records from multiple sources. The second phase involves taking that abstracted data and having another set of expert clinician reviewers determine whether or not the child meets the ASD case definition. So the way in which the CDC ADAM network identifies a case of autism has to do with a retrospective record review. We're relying on information that is present in the children's records or multiple records for specific children. So this slide summarizes the prevalence estimates that have been reported by the ADAM network since its inception. And they first reported prevalence in a 2000 study year. Again, this is all in 8-year-old children. And most recently, the 1 in 68 comes from a surveillance year of 2010. And you can see there's this pretty significant change from 1 in 150 in 2000 to 1 in 68 in 2010. And in the surveillance years 2004 and 2006, this is when the Florida site that I was part of, I was the principal investigator, contributed prevalence numbers from our area in Florida to these nationwide estimates. And this is a slide of the current ADAM states, where they're located and what disabilities they are monitoring. Okay. We know there's lots of children and individuals with autism in the United States. Another thing we know is that it costs a lot of money. This $2.3 million is a recent estimate of the lifetime cost of having an autism spectrum disorder if you also have a very low IQ. This number is slightly lower. $1.4 million, if you will, if you have an autism spectrum disorder without a very low IQ. One of the things these researchers noticed was that a majority of the costs for this particular disorder are non-medical costs, things like intervention services and special education and child daycare and adult residential placements that are necessary when the individual is older. It also takes into account loss of parental productivity. Mothers of children on the spectrum tend to take more days off. They tend to be in jobs that may pay less. And again, any of these services which are necessary to sort of improve daily living and daily functioning of individuals costs families a tremendous amount of money. Again, this is going back to number of children. So think about 2.3 million times 20,000. Because this represents the number of students in Illinois that are receiving special education services under an autism exceptionality category. And you can see that this number has increased from 2000 to 2013. These numbers I got from the Easter Seals website. One of the things that I'm kind of concerned about has to do with the number of individuals who are receiving services between the ages of 18 and 21. So we've got a significant number of younger children receiving services, but fewer and fewer as they get older. Why this is concerning to me is because many times services after individuals turn 21 and can no longer access them from the public schools tend to be fairly limited. So all of these children that have an autism spectrum disorder are eventually going to become adults. And their need for services and their need for support doesn't disappear when they're no longer in school. Okay, 2004 is a significant year because this was, in addition to my son being born, was when the CDC first rolled out their Learn the Signs, Act Early campaign. So this campaign was intended to improve early identification of children with autism spectrum disorders and other developmental disabilities so that families can get the services and the support that they need. And the Learn the Signs, Act Early campaign has three different components: a health education component, an Act Early initiative, and then research and evaluation. One of the practical aspects of this campaign were a set of developmental milestones that were sort of specific to different ages, translated in many different languages, and distributed to parents, to early child care centers, to pediatricians' offices. And the idea was that if parents and other individuals who work with young children are kind of looking for some of these early developmental signs or these areas where children may not be meeting these milestones, they can refer the child for more comprehensive evaluation, their diagnosis would happen earlier, and they can start services earlier. Okay, so this is another study that some of my Eureka students worked with me, and this was looking at whether or not parents' awareness of early signs of ASD were matching some of the things that the CDC were telling parents to look at. So the purpose was to, again, examine some of this data that I had brought with me from Miami, where parents were reporting their first initial concern that they had of their child and sort of mapping that with some of the concerns identified by the CDC Learn the Signs program. So this was a smaller sample, 238 children, again, primarily Hispanic, primarily male. And when they went through the records, they found 362 different behaviors that were identified as early concerns. When they mapped those to the categories that had been sort of designated by the CDC, they found that a majority of the concerns, about 80%, were ones that the CDC were sort of telling people to look at, in particular, ones that had to do with communication impairments and language delays. And again, this was another poster that was, presentation that was accepted at the Gatlinburg conference, and they got to talk about these results as well. Okay. So 68,153,478. This was the amount of money that Autism Speaks raised last year through their fundraising efforts. Autism Speaks was an organization that was founded by Bob and Suzanne Wright. They are grandparents of a child with autism, And since its inception 10 years ago, it has grown into one of the leading science and advocacy organizations for ASD, which involves research into finding causes, prevention, effective treatments, increasing awareness of autism spectrum disorder, and advocating for the needs of individuals and their families that are affected by the disorder. So thank goodness for Autism Speaks. And the last number I want to talk about is one, and that refers to our friend Julia. Julia is the first Muppet that has an autism spectrum disorder, and she debuted just a few weeks ago on Sesame Street. Julia is significant because, like I said, she's the first character on the Sesame Street series that has autism. And the goal is to try and introduce younger children to individuals like Julia who may act differently because their brains are acting or functioning or working a little bit differently. They want to increase the awareness of autism spectrum disorders starting very young and educate children and their parents on how to have successful interactions with children on the spectrum. It's interesting that they picked a girl for this character, because like I said, it's 5 times more likely to be boys. But one of the things that they were purposeful in doing is making sure that people don't think it only happens to boys. And you can see, I know the picture's a little blurry, but she's carrying a feather, which is an example of one of those items that they like to carry around with them. Okay, so where do we go from here? There are a lot of things that we can go from here. One of the things that has just come up has to do with advocating for universal early screening for autism spectrum disorders. Several groups, including the American Academy of Pediatrics, have recommended that all children between the ages of 18 and 24 be screened for an autism spectrum disorder so that if there are issues, they can be referred for more comprehensive evaluations. That is not happened. The task force that reviewed the proposal believes that more research and more evidence needs to happen before they can make that recommendation. But there are a lot of people involved in the autism community that think this is a really, really important first step. Some of these screening instruments are very easy to administer, can be done fairly quickly. Again, you can't make a diagnosis from a screening instrument, but it can identify some red flags that you may use to refer a child for more comprehensive evaluation. Again, I think another focus has to be on improving transition services. A lot of focus on autism has been on little kids, and a lot of services are focused on younger individuals. Like I said, those children will grow up to be adults, and their parents will many times assume the challenge of being responsible for many of those individuals as the parents and the child grow older. At the Gatlinburg conference last year, I went to a poster from a graduate student in Tennessee, and she did interviews with students who were turning 21 and exiting the education system. And one of their biggest sort of worries was, what do I do now? Because there wasn't an obvious place for them to receive services or receive support or even know where to go once they left the public school system. So I really think it's important that we continue to focus on our young ones, but we also shift that spotlight to our older individuals as well. Examining risk factors. So I talked about some results having to do with prevalence studies. Prevalence studies are really useful because they can give us some baseline descriptive data of areas or certain groups of individuals where the occurrence of disorders like autism spectrum disorders or other diseases are much more common. But we can't really identify any type of causal agents in these larger prevalence studies. So I think that taking some of the data that we have as far as what we know, how common the disorder is, looking at some of the disparities based on sex, on socioeconomic status, on race, and doing some more carefully controlled risk factor studies such that we might identify potential causal agents as well. And then I think it's important to expand surveillance efforts. Again, the fact that the CDC is still continuing monitoring autism has expanded it slightly. It's a long and arduous process. It's important, but it takes a long time. Go back to the slide that had the table, the number of sites that contributed data to those estimates range anywhere from 8 to 14. Depending on money, will determine how many sites are doing prevalence. The more areas that we have information as far as the occurrence of autism, the more valid and reliable our prevalence estimates will be. And I think finally, the last take-home message is to focus on the individual. One of the things that I talk with my students is that instead of calling, a person, referring to someone as an autistic child, we are better served to refer to them as a child with autism, to focus on the individual first, to understand that they have their own specific individual challenges, strengths, and ability to respond and contribute to larger society. And as long as we keep focusing on the individual, I think we will be moving in the right direction. So that being said, I have a lot of people to acknowledge, all of the children, family, and service providers that I've worked with that have provided their time and their stories and their information. All of my colleagues at the University of Miami, from my mentors to my graduate students to my research staff, the people I worked with at Vanderbilt, all of the folks at the CDC, including Dr. Kathy Wright, Rice, who was the PI of the ADAM network when I was there, and then all of my colleagues here at Eureka, including my wonderful students, Thomas Brewer, Katie Miller, and Lauren Schwanke. Thank you. Are there any questions I can take? Yes. Oh man, oh man. It's really, really hard to convince people that it's not accurate. And I'm firmly on the side, there is no link between vaccines and the cause of autism. Study after study after study have failed to demonstrate this relationship. The first hint of this being a cause was a paper that was published, was in The Lancet, and I don't remember when it was. That study has since been discredited. The main author has had his medical license taken away. It was demonstrated that he had a financial stake with some groups that were suing the vaccine company. The other co-authors have since distanced themselves and say they no longer agree with the results. One of the issues with vaccines is it's believed that a certain preservative called thimerosal is what might be triggering autism in children that have the vaccines because it contains some level of mercury. But thimerosal hasn't been in our vaccines here in the United States, I think, since 2001. And we see this increase continuing after that was removed. In other countries, thimerosal is still in those vaccines, and we're not seeing an 8 times increase, right? We're seeing similar increases to what we're having. So it's very difficult, and I've had many conversations with many parents about it. I understand the need to want a cause. That is not the cause. Yeah, so autism spectrum disorders are interesting. Many developmental disorders, including intellectual disabilities, what we used to call mental retardation, we see much higher rates of that in individuals who come from lower socioeconomic status, who come from minority ethnic groups, blacks and Hispanics. and sort of a lower parental education. We see the opposite pattern with autism spectrum disorders. We see higher rates in from parents with higher education and higher SES, and in pretty much all of our studies, or all of our prevalent sites, except for maybe Florida, my site, we saw a higher prevalence of ASD identified in white children. Now, some of the reasons for this might be that parents who have more education are more likely to be seeking out these sort of comprehensive services early on and looking for a diagnosis for their child that is not behaving the way other children are. There's also, now I said my Florida data kind of bucks against that trend, but the thing with our Florida Hispanics is our catchment area was in Miami-Dade County, and Hispanics in Miami-Dade County are of a different socioeconomic status and education status compared to Hispanics in Arizona or in California. They are much more educated have higher education, and they tend to be in a higher SES category. And we saw about equal numbers of ASD diagnosis in our Hispanic and in our white children in that particular sample. So it kind of goes against the trend of what we see in some other developmental disabilities. But again, I think that might likely have to do with what some of these parents are more likely pushing for. Yes, Dr. Arnold. Hand flapping. Maybe. When you're making a choice, I guess, about what's the best diagnosis, you oftentimes look at what is sort of having the most effect on the person's daily functioning. Is it possible, and we have a pretty substantial subset of individuals on the autism spectrum that have very low IQs. It used to be thought that all individuals on the spectrum have intellectual disabilities, that they all are in that level of low IQ mental retardation. That's not the case. Many, in fact, a large proportion of individuals on the spectrum have normal and in some very gifted IQs, but there are still some that have those very, very low intelligence scores. Oftentimes, individuals that are more, are lower functioning, are more severe, those are oftentimes the easier ones to maybe diagnose and identify. I think some of the challenges that some of the families I've talked with, as they've gone to doctor, to try and get a diagnosis, is that they had some behaviors that weren't abnormal, right? They walked on time, and they were somewhat compliant, and they had a good vocabulary, and that they could name everything in the, testing booklet, but they couldn't have a conversation, right? When someone is banging their head or nonverbal and not making eye contact, it's pretty clear, oh my gosh, that person has autism. But an individual that has more sort of milder forms of the symptoms may very well be on the spectrum, but it may not be as obvious and it may not be diagnosed as early. There are several individuals that are coming out now as adults that are being diagnosed for the very first time. So it can kind of go both ways. It can make it difficult when they're very low functioning, but it can also be challenging when they're high functioning as well. One of the things that we know is that early intervention services, in particular to improve language, and to improve social interaction skills can be really, really beneficial. They can actually decrease, it costs more initially to put out, but it can decrease some of the lifetime expense that it costs for families and the individual themselves. There is a subset of children who demonstrated more severe impairments when they were younger, and after early intervention, they're able to improve enough that some of them don't meet diagnostic criteria any longer. It's not something that can be cured, right? It's not something that goes away, but there definitely can be strategies that can be taught, but again, it sort of focuses on these core areas of social interaction, which are so important in so many aspects of everyday life, communication, which are also really important, and then being able to control some of those challenging behaviors. So it's definitely possible that, I know that starting early with services can improve functioning, but you may, even if you have, you know, your behaviors and strategies that are improved enough, you may still need support in a lot of different areas. There was just a movie or a documentary, I think that was on HBO, about some teenagers with autism spectrum disorders that were getting ready to attend their first dance, right? So something that many of us take for granted, right, as something that you do is a big struggle for them, right? Their social skills are impaired enough that it's not a natural thing to do. And the documentary was sort of tracking their journey through learning some of these social skills that they would need in a dance and then applying them with other individuals as well. It's really, really interesting. Those that are more severely affected will many times continue to need constant care. And if you've worked with a nonverbal, very aggressive child when they are two, and that child grows up to be a 250-pound, 30-year-old that is still nonverbal and is still aggressive and has a very low IQ, that is very, very difficult for parents, for siblings, and for other individuals that may be taking care of them. So it's a pretty significant thing that I think we have to continue to pay attention to. Renee? They've identified, so the study that I talked about of the 16,000 genetic profiles that they looked at, all that 16,000 had a neurodevelopmental disorder, some of which were autism. What they found was that 1% of the sample with autism had a common mutation, which doesn't seem like a lot, right? But it was, and I don't have the particular gene written down, but it was a gene that they found is also associated with higher risks of manic depression or bipolar disorder, higher risk of schizophrenia, higher risk of, I want to say maybe ADHD. So it's not a gene that is going to explain all cases, but in some individuals that have that mutation, they might be at even more vulnerable than, I guess, just males in general. What, any sort of? Yeah, so that's one of the things that they're looking at, right? They're looking at areas where there may be some of these environmental agents, right, which might be contributing to some of these genetic mutations. Absolutely. They've looked at lead. They've looked at mercury. They looked at something else. One of the things the surveillance studies can do is they can kind of pinpoint certain areas where we might want to focus and do more in-depth studies. In 1987, before the CDC sort of started their major monitoring network, they did a surveillance study in Brick Township, New Jersey. So this was before we had really good estimates of autism, but individuals in that area that were near some power plants believed that they had more children that were being diagnosed with autism than would be expected based on what we knew at the time. And so the CDC went in there and they did a very in-depth study, and they did find that the prevalence was higher. They couldn't necessarily link some environmental agents, but they didn't rule it out that that was what might be contributing to it. One of the things that can be challenging is, like I said, in this one particular study, they identified that females with autism spectrum disorders may have more of these mutations on the X chromosome, but they're not developed, but they may not be have sort of full-blown development of the disorder. They might have more mild symptoms, right? They may be passing on that vulnerability to their children, right? Because, and if their children are male and they don't have some of that protective from the other X, then their children are more likely to be diagnosed later on. So it's not as clear cut like I'm exposed to this and I've developed this mutation. It may be something that we have to go back and look at mothers and grandmothers of some of the individuals that they've identified. So look at sort of family genetic profiles, which I know several areas are doing, several institutions are doing. Yes?
I'm curious, obviously there are a lot of limitations, life limitations for people in the spectrum, but yeah, you look at people with Asperger's. Mm-hmm.
Someone that can be very focused and very fixated and, you know what I mean, very detailed oriented, absolutely can have skills that might be very valued in certain situations. Asperger's syndrome, in previous versions, has the social interaction difficulties, has some of the restricted interests and repetitive behaviors, but one of the things we don't see with individuals with Asperger's are some of the communication delays. They do have some sort of odd communication styles, but they're much more functional when it comes with their ability to communicate. And individuals that have better language skills and higher IQs tend to have a better prognosis. I should have put a picture, I didn't even think. The common reading that we read this year for freshman seminar, the main character was an individual on the autism spectrum, and he was brilliant at math. So yes, that's a skill that might be highly valued in certain circumstances. Grandin, she was here a couple of years ago, and it was fascinating. Mm-hmm. With the Disney characters? In a way to connect. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And I had one little boy that I worked with at Vanderbilt. His focus was Pokemon characters. So these Pokemon characters have these strange names, right? And there's a bazillion of them. And I became an expert in Pokemon characters, right? Because that was what I needed to get him to work with me on some of the skills that we wanted to improve. Because he would do it when we would use the Pokemon characters. I was also very popular with my nephews at the time because I knew all about Pokemon characters and I had lots of Pokemon cards. So you do that. I do think that's right. Their interests can be a conduit to some of these intervention pathways that can help them improve skills that they need. So yes, I totally agree. And that is, I didn't know that I heard about the book that he wrote, but I'll be on the lookout for the documentary as well. Great. Holly. Absolutely. So one of the projects that, or one of the writing assignments that I have my abnormal psychology class do is they have to diagnose a character in a TV show, a movie, or a book with a certain developmental disability. And I've had several people diagnose Sheldon from The Big Bang Theory with an autism spectrum disorder. And you know, in the assignment, they have to describe different characteristics and justify and explain why that character meets the criteria. There was a television show, Parenthood, not that long ago. And one of the main storylines was one of the families sort of dealing with the fact that it was discovered that their, I think, 11 or 12-year-old had Asperger's syndrome. And he was a significant character because he wasn't sort of he wasn't Tommy Westfall. You know, he wasn't Ring Man. That's not the only depiction that we have. So I do think we're moving towards that. And one of the things that Julia, our Muppet, is hoping to do is to demonstrate in a cartoon, but demonstrate to young children that even though there may be these differences, they can still be your friend, right? And I think the story that's sort of focused is one of Elmo's friends, Abby Kadabi, I think is her name. She thinks Julia doesn't like her because Julia never looks at her and doesn't want to talk to her. And what Elmo explains is Julia just does things differently. And if we, let's talk in numbers because Julia likes numbers. And so they start, again, counting, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and Julia gets involved in that game. So I think we are moving towards that. I think there's always, when I ask my students, like, what do you think of, a lot of them say Rain Man is what they think. But I think we are making some progress with that, and it can only get better. Any other questions? Again, thank you so much for coming out and staying. I feel like I've gabbed a lot, so I appreciate it, and I answer any other questions later. Thank you.